Faye's family and friends, we want to thank you and welcome you to be with us today. We're here to grieve. We're here to also share joy, to remember, to realize we've been gifted in such a tremendous way by this one life. And that in turn makes us grateful to our God who has given us this opportunity. So we're not here solely saying goodbye to a loved one. We're here to honor God. This is not just a burial. This is a Christian burial. And we celebrate that together. God's been good to all of us. And in moments when we think about Faye, it reminds us just how much God has been good to us for years, decades. And so it is that we come with grateful hearts, certainly grieving hearts, but grateful hearts. The Psalms are 150 chapters. And if you are not too terribly well acquainted with them, you may think, well, they're all basically praise chapters. There's a lot of them that way. But there's a lot of them that are grief chapters. Grief is very much a legitimate response to what we are experiencing right now. But you'll notice that I've got a little bit of a smile on the face because there's more than the grief, too. And we will deal with that along the way in the upcoming moments. But we lean on, trust in, and depend on our Lord through his Spirit power in moments like this. So let's go together to our first moment to talk with our God in prayer. Our Father, we come to you right now, each of us with heavy hearts, some far more heavy than others, just by virtue of the deep levels of commitment and ties and love to Faye. Our Lord, we ask that you would be present among us in a powerful way so that we would sense your presence, not solely to comfort us, but to also magnify your good work in this world and what you did through this one believer, Faye, and how you have her with you at home now. We ask, Lord, that you help us to have calm spirits, but also that you would challenge us to live every single day of this world and this life that we have been given freely by you to the ultimate that we could live it in the glory of Christ. Help us to be like Faye, Lord, in so many ways with her kindness and her pleasantness and her deep faith and hope. Help us to be people of hope. Help us to revel and work together and share commitments of our kind of a deep understanding of what you do in this world and how you give us life, and then life is taken away, but nevertheless, as Job would say, praise the name of the Lord. Help us to be about that as we don't just walk together hand in hand through this funeral, but we recognize your presence among us here too. In Christ's name we pray these things. Amen. I have a clergy record for Lily Faye Kennedy Hill. I'd like to read to you. Lily Faye Kennedy Hill went to be with our Lord and Savior, her Lord and Savior, Monday, May 25 of this year. She was surrounded by her loving family. She was a former member of Preston Highlands Baptist Church in Dallas for over 40 years. During those years, she served as in the children's department. Her passion was teaching little ones from age nursery through preschool about Jesus the Christ. She served as a deacon's wife and was the church clerk for many years. Faye was a homemaker, and she loved taking care of her family. God, family, and church were her life. She worked at taking care of that family, and she worked at Texas AgriLife Research and Extension Center, retiring in 2013 after 29 years of service. After retiring, Faye moved to Crowley, Louisiana to live with her daughter, Judy Falk, and her family. There she joined First Baptist Church of Crowley with Dr. Cullen Clark as pastor. She became an active member of the Soul Sisters Sunday School class. That's a pretty good, great name, Soul Sisters Sunday School class. In 2020 of January, she moved back to Texas to live with her daughters, Jackie and Melissa. Faye is survived by a wonderful group of loving people, including daughters Judy Falk and her husband Joel of Crowley, Louisiana, Jackie Heistand, Melissa Kelly and husband Chris of Plano, Texas. Grandchildren include Autumn Zelaya, Josh Falk and wife Heidi, Justin Highstand, Brandon Highstand and Terry and Carrie Tran, Katie Ludlow and husband Jared, Cassidy Kelly, Jack Kelly, and Emily Kelly. Great-grandchildren include Micah Falk, Estella Zelaya, Declan, if I pronounce that wrong, my apologies, Highstand, and Ridley Falk, a sister, Linda Thomas, and a brother, Jimmy Kennedy. She was preceded in death by her beloved husband, Jack Hill, of Plano, Texas, parents Ruby and Evelyn Kennedy, brothers Bill Kennedy, Frankie Kennedy, and Troy Kennedy, devoted sister, Doris Hill, precious niece, Marcia Kennedy, and baby granddaughter, Kirsten Leanne Highstand. We will continue on with the service.
Consider all.
Psalm 103 says this: "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles." Then down in verse 11 it says, "For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is away from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame, he remembers that we are dust." Then the last few verses it says, "Bless the Lord, O you angels, the mighty ones who do his word, hearkening the voice. Bless the Lord, all hosts, ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places and dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." What drew you here today? Why are you here? You're here because of love. Nobody made you come. You could have boycotted, but you came out of deep love for Faye. Love compelled you, brought you here. And through that love, we can talk about one who gave us that love, our own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and provides hope for us, hope for every single one of us. In Luke 4, at the first of Jesus' ministry, in verses 18 and 19, he takes a scroll from Isaiah, opens it up in the temple, and begins to read about what he would be doing in the next 3 years of his own ministry. And he talks about these kind of things: providing freedom for the captives, healing the brokenhearted, giving sight to the blind. Some of us at times are blind in life. Boy, we may have good vision, but I'm talking about blind to the goodness of God and how he's blessed us with family members and people who mean the most to us. And he also is here to bring us a sense of relief from being brokenhearted, as you must feel at this moment. I'd like to talk to you today about the brevity of life, and you, whether you're 20 or 60 or 90 years old, you really have to admit life is basically short. But I want you to talk to you about the blessings of life also, and the ultimate hope that we have. One time my wife and I were on a road trip. She was sleeping in the car, which she's prone to either be reading or sleeping in the car. And so we were going through a forest, and it was winter time, and there were no leaves on the trees, but giant oak trees, spindly branches going in all directions against an azure blue sky. And I personally thought it was extremely beautiful, to the point that I woke up my wife and I said, "Look at the trees." And she opened her eyes and said, "They're dead." I said, no, they're not dead. They're just sleeping. They're going to come out and flourish in another couple of months. And God is providing for us that kind of a message that, yes, we've lost faith. Yes, it looks like, it appears like to you and me that she would be sleeping right now. But with the eyes of faith, we know what has happened. We know that God is good to her because she had the kind of hope that we all need in this world. So I'd ask you, do you have that hope? I'd ask you also to do some introspection and do these kind of things. First, hold on tight to the good memories that you had of Faye. Hold on to them. Think about them. Recite them to yourself tomorrow and next week and next month and next year. I'd also say, besides hold on to the good memories, hold on tight to your friends that you have, your family members, yourselves, and others who love Faye who could not be here with us today. Hold on tight to those people. They make a difference in your life too. And through both of those ideas of the memories and the friends, hold on tight to our Lord and his presence in your life. And that is such a leveling thing that it amazes people. A young guy in East Texas was a youth director. The truth was, he was a college student, sensed into the ministry, sensed a kind of a call into ministry. And during the summer, he helped a little church doing the coordination of youth activities. So he got to be the youth minister for the summer. He was full of energy, tremendous level of confidence, and little ability, little education, little training. And in the midst of that summer, one of the young ladies, a 16-year-old girl of the church, contracted cancer. And she was in the hospital. The pastor could not go see her, and so this young, fresh youth minister went to see her at the bedside of the hospital. She was the finest young lady in the youth group and a deep faith already at the age of 16, but it looked like her life would be ending soon. So he went into that room in a very awkward situation, and he looked at her, and they talked, he chit-chatted a while, and after a little while, he had a moment of prayer. He stammered through the prayer, and he finished it with an amen, and then she looked at him and smiled and said, "Do you ever know what it's been like to be without hope?" And that question just seared his heart. He stammered a few words and then finally said to her, "Well, I have to admit, life has been good for me, and no, I don't know what it's like to be without hope." She smiled from that bed and said, "I don't either." She had tremendous hope, because she knew her Lord and Savior was there to take care of her because of the power of the cross. And I can't talk to you too much or explain that too much in a very few minutes, but maybe a little monarch butterfly would help. One time last year, I stepped out into our backyard and I saw a little monarch land actually on my finger. And I realized that he was just a traveler coming through. But see, his home was up in Saskatchewan or Montana, somewhere like that. He was flying 5,000 miles to go down to the Casa de los Leones down in Mexico in the mountains there to spend the winter. And I realized at that moment that if God could infuse in that little tiny brain and provide the enough energy for that little monarch butterfly to fly all the way from Canada down to the middle of Mexico, that I'm absolutely certain He can take care of your life, your struggles, your problems, and your need for Him. And He wants to do that just as He has done that for Faye. If Faye were with us right now, she would be nodding and smiling when I would say, Jesus told us in John 14:6, "I go to prepare a place for you." And don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Later in that same group of words, He said, "I will come again." Can you imagine that? Our own Lord loved us enough to go to a cross for us, die for our sins. He was sinless, and He took upon Himself all that we deserved, opening us the ability to go to be with Him in heaven. And in that whole process, He gave everything. People believe it. People in this room believe it. They've given their lives to it. You may have heard of Dr. David Livingston, I presume, that old line. Well, there really was a David Livingston who served in Africa for many years. And then as he retired and came back to London, he walked down the aisle of the Westminster Abbey. But walking it was really saying, being gracious in saying it that way, because he basically drug one foot. He had one limp arm, and he drug his foot down. The arm was due to a lion attack. The foot was due to a disease for which he never completely recovered, total mobility. And he drug himself down the aisle, got up in the pulpit, and said, "Do you wonder what sustained me all through those dark years in Africa?" And he said, "It was the promise of a gentleman." And then he spoke about who Jesus was to him. The one who said, "I will prepare a place for you. I will come back for you. I am the way, the truth, and the life." Faye knew that. Faye wants you to know that. And I pray that you would listen to these kinds of words and these kind of ideas right now. Romans 8 provides a tremendous opportunity for us to grasp a little bit of God's goodness. Down in verse 31 it says, "What shall we say to this? If God's for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all good things? It's Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised from the dead, who's at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, peril, or the sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us." And then if you don't think Paul is wound up tight enough, listen to these last words. "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers or height or depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Folks, that is big stuff, if you don't know. Faye knew it. Faye celebrated it. Faye lived it, as did her husband before. And God is asking us not just to simply be a part of a celebration like this of a wonderful life rendered to God, but also that we would respond to Him in similar fashion. I think one of the greatest things I ever heard was a particular hymn that stated this way. I heard it at a funeral in Austin, Texas, an extremely tragic situation where a biker, the father of one of my close friends, riding on the side of the road, safely was run into by a car and lost his life in the prime of life. And there at First Methodist Church in Austin, they started the service with what I thought was not necessarily apt as a thematic hymn for a funeral. And then I realized, no, it's extremely apt, extremely representative of who we should be at this point. And it's the first and last verses go like this. God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Crown thy ancient church's story, bring her bud to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the facing of this hour. The last stanza, set our feet on lofty places, gird our lives that they may be armored with all Christ-like graces in the fight to set men free. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, that we never fail thee. There was one guy in the Old Testament named Job. And for whatever reason, I don't know if it's the pandemic or many other factors in my life, but I'm drawn to the book of Job, and I've been studying it again, and I'm reading a book called The Theology of Suffering. And yes, right here, we're suffering. You're suffering. And you ought to admit that very much. But through that, there are little threads of God's goodness and God's grace. And even Job, who had little of the scripture at hand back in the days when he lived, knew something about that. And in the 24th chapter of Job, he declares openly, after losing everything, after having his whole life in shambles, and he still says, I know that my Redeemer lives. What wonderful, tremendous hope. It's the hope that Faye had. It's the hope that she wants you to have. And she invites you, and I invite you, to be listening to God in His words today. There's another particular hymn that we sing at times. It's called, We're Marching to Zion. Listen to these words. Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. The hill of Zion yields a thousand secret sweets before we can reach the heavenly fields and walk the golden streets. Then let our song abound and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground to fairer worlds on high. In Mexico City, where I used to live, there's a guy named Arturo Alarcón. I wish you could meet him. He's in his 90s now. He was an original street kid in the 1920s, the roaring 20s in Mexico City. Not an easy and safe place to be in the 1920s. He did not have a mom and dad. As a 12-year-old, he was running the family, which included his 7-year-old little brother. He lived, actually, on the streets. And one time he had the little 7-year-old go down to get some tortillas and gave him a little money, and the little 7-year-older never came back. And for years, it haunted Arturo. He grew up, eventually developed his own restaurant business, and eventually became a Christian in his 20s. All prior to that, between the age of 12 and the mid-20s, he constantly looked around town. Everywhere he went, he was looking for his little brother, looking for somebody who had a face like his face, desperately wanting to find what happened to his little brother. Finally, when he became a Christian, God gave him a peace, a calmness, a kind of rest that he needed, because that whole specter of knowing, not knowing about the brother was breaking him down. But Jesus gave him something more. He gave him answers to life, and he in turn dedicated his life to Christ. I would pray that each of us this day would see that we can be new creatures, just as Faye is right now. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that if we're in Christ, we're a new creation. The old is past, and behold, everything is now new. So I ask you, is everything new for you? Would you like to follow in the faith steps that Faye has taken and be able to celebrate life with your loved ones toward the end and closure of life? My own father, a Christian, said that he wanted me to speak at his funeral. I hesitated. I said, "Oh, no, Dad, I don't think I can do that." And he looked at me in his matter-of-fact, near no feeling, no emotion status, and he said, "Well, you believe the gospel, don't you? You know what we're talking about, don't you? You're going to be happy for me, aren't you?" And I said, "You're right," and I gladly did it for him. So here we are, saying goodbye. Say goodbye and hurts. It's not easy. And it will be continuously difficult for the family members, the loved ones, a year, 2 years, 3 years from now. The intensity of the loss will subside a little bit, but then there will be a maintaining of the still a sense of deep loss as long as we live. We don't have faith anymore. But we do have the presence of God, and we know where faith is, and we can console ourselves in that and realize that God likewise wants us to be part of flying away with him. So I pray that we would be about that today as people of faith and hope and fly.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to that home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to that land where joy will never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
I have just a moment of another prayer and benediction. You may know that the word benediction mainly means a blessing, that you're being sent out, and you have the chance to be a representative of Christ. Let's pray. Our Lord, again, we thank you for already doing the comforting work that you so well do through your Spirit. We grieve the loss of Faye. We're grateful for her life. We're grateful for the chance to hug each other and share our stories with each other of how much she meant to us. But Lord, at the same time, you have us as messengers to continue on the good work that Faye has done, and that we'd be just as loving as Faye was, as forgiving as Faye was, as positive of an attitude as Faye had, as wonderfully supportive of her family members as Faye constantly was. We pray, Lord, that we would be inspired by her life and pass it around to each other. And console us, Lord, in the moments where we don't know where to turn, where we're fearful about the future, where we wonder, even in complacency, if we can ever muster up enough strength to live for you. We pray, Lord, that you would convict us, empower us, use us for your work in this world. And Lord, all along the way, help us to remember your presence with us. May the power of God be with everyone here and also as we go out to the cemetery. In his name, Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.